like to talk Israel. We would like to talk Israeli startups. Why are they so successful? What we can learn from? Why are they so good? So please give a big hand for some of the greatest names of Israel's high tech. Please welcome Yoav Ishar Prato, the CEO and founder of Kenshu. Come on, Yoav. Please welcome Shaul Olmert, co-founder and CEO of Playbuzz. Thank you. And welcome Adam Shingula, CEO and founder of Taboola. And ladies and gentlemen, this very panel is hosted by the one and only, the most beautiful one, the greatest one, is Yossi Vardi. Yeah. Thank you. Have fun.
Thank you very much.
Very nice to meet you all. And it's wonderful to be here in Dimexco one more. First, I would like to introduce you to the panel, and we are going to do it a little bit different. Instead of everybody introducing himself or I introducing them, I ask each one of the panel members to introduce another panel member. So why don't we start with you, Adam Shingula? Whom do you want to introduce?
First of all, great to be here. Thanks for having me. I'll take Shaul.
Go ahead.
Yeah, I have 30 seconds, 60 seconds. Just go.
Go.
Right. So at first we had articles, then we had galleries, then we had videos, and now we have Playbuzz. Playbuzz make the web entertaining, interactive, especially in a social world, so the future of the web can be fun and entertaining. Welcome,
Amen.
Playbuzz.
Thank you.
And if you want to invest, we accept investment, ratchets, liquidation preferences, everything.
Make checks payable to Shaul Olmert.
Personally.
Exactly.
Yes.
Shaul, how did you like the way Adam introduced you?
That's a tough act to follow, but let me try and reciprocate to the gentleman on my left. You know, his look is a little bit deceiving because, you know, you see him and, you know, you don't understand what kind of a powerhouse sits here to my left. So, Yoav something is the founder and CEO of Kenshu. And Kenshu is the company that makes the self-serving platforms of the internet accessible on a wide scale. Because most of the big advertisers in the world are using Kenshu in order to unleash the power of Google and Facebook for search and social ads. So thanks to Kenshu's platform, those platforms can actually be used not only by small businesses and mom and pop shops, but really by the big whales of the advertising world.
Wow. And I heard 12% of the world search budget goes through Kenshu. That's just a
You obviously didn't get the memo. That was like so yesterday.
Like an hour ago.
It's growing, you know, it's growing by the minute.
Okay.
So, right. Rob, how will you rate this kind of cheap promotion that Shaul has done for you?
It's for free. What do you mean? It's advertising pays for the
talk. Good ROI.
That's good. I want to show you how Israelis are taking care of each other. Yoav, whom you are going to introduce?
I guess there is only one left. I'm still trying to recover from the preparations we had from Yossi. If you don't know Yossi, you should get to know him. Adam, I guess. Adam and Taboola, I think it speaks for itself. This dude landed 2 hours ago, he's now here, and he's, in 2 hours he's out of here. That's Adam, that's Taboola, working fast, being relevant, and I think at the end of the day, trying to change the way how content is being consumed, that it comes to you, to us as consumers versus us needing to work hard for it. So. Disruption all over.
Adam, what are you doing?
What?
What your company is doing? I was unable to figure it out.
I think it was good. And last time Yoav and I were on stage, we had a beer. And here they don't serve beers to us.
They don't serve beer, but they have water.
And no, that's a good. It's
you know, water is becoming less and less available in the world. Why don't you drink it before it disappears?
Scarce resource. So Taboola connects people with information they may like and never knew existed. So you've seen us before. If you went to many, many websites at the bottom of the article or on a homepage, you'll see you may also like, similar to what you see on Amazon when you buy a product. So we do that.
Very, very humble people.
Very.
Very humble people. So. Yoav, thank you very much. Shaul, thank you very much. Adam, thank you very much. How old are your companies, quickly?
Nine.
Nine?
Five.
Five?
Ten.
Ten. revenues.
I'm always the youngest. It's great.
You're always the youngest. It will pass, you know. Any other metrics you want to share with the public?
So Taboola now reaches 1 billion people a month. We serve 14 billion recommendations every day.
You are familiar with the recommendation? These are the annoying little pictures at the end.
That's my part, the annoying part. And we'll generate over $500 million this year. Company is profitable. And
$500 million.
Yeah, and we raised money from some great investors, Israeli investors, Pitengo and others, as well as Baidu, Yahoo Japan, LVMH, Comcast, and many, many others.
Did you ever believe that you will sell anything for $500 million a year?
No, that's my first job, so it's the first paycheck I had to pay myself.
This is the first job that you are doing in your life?
Yeah.
Amazing. Did your mother believe that you will be able to do it?
My mom, I think, wanted me to be a lawyer. And I don't think she still understands what I do, but if I, you know, I keep trying to pitch at home.
Didn't she try to convince you to go and do some decent work instead of...
Yeah, my dad wanted me to debate between being a pianist to a lawyer and anything in between. But, you know, I didn't make my Jewish mother happy just yet.
Okay, you never will be able, but this is a different story. Shaul, Matrix, numbers.
So we have a bunch of great high-level metrics to show off with. I'll scan through them very, very quickly. We are serving tens of thousands of publishers, including some of the world's largest content companies like Disney and News Corp.
Impress us,
Viacom,
throw some names, you know.
NAOL, and all of those that are using our platform. We are reaching hundreds of millions of users every month. But beyond all of that, what I'm really proud of is the fact that our system is open and accessible for everyone. And is being used not only by all those huge media conglomerates, but also by a lot of smaller publishers and blogs that for them we are really a lifeline because they don't have the editorial steps to create a lot of content. And through our system, they can create content that is really engaging and really social and really
like
reaching a lot of people.
What animal are you, for instance, yes?
All kinds of...
What piece of furniture are you?
That's a separate discussion. Our content platform enables everyone to create content in a bunch of very structured, very highly curated content formats that tend to be more popular and more engaging.
Yoav, tell us a little bit about your company.
Kenshu. So Kenshu started because we were growing frustrated trying to build a business. This thing called web was becoming increasingly troublesome in terms of losing more money the more you grow the business. It was a very simple equation. And it seemed to us that there should be a technology to help you grow your business using the internet. So we started with Google, expanded into all this what we call search. But then Facebook came along, and
anybody heard about Facebook? Raise your hand. Nobody knows about it. Nobody knows what you're talking.
Yeah, exactly. and Facebook kind of together with the Googles of the world showed us the light in the sense that marketeers needs to get back to what they were, which is marketing. Way too deep we went into the channels trying to do tactical stuff. Not anymore we tend to think about the consumer and what is the actual message and experience we want to deliver. And we think there is a way to have technology do all that stuff while marketers become creative again and deliver excitement. We have 500 plus people around the world. There is about 4,000 clicks every second, so clear, very clear intent signals. And $350 billion of sales that we see through the system. The company is profitable and it's a software business, something that we learned from Sequoia. Stick to software, it's a better route. So life is good.
Good. One question which doesn't belong to the company is we had an argument about the fact that Shaul is the only one who have a jacket among us. And we had a discussion what is more suitable for this type of conference, to come like leisurely or to come looking like with a jacket. So I want to make a poll of the crowd to ask you who thinks that Shaul should continue with the jacket and who thinks Shaul should starting taking his jacket off. So who thinks that Shaul should stay with the jacket? Please raise your hand.
Thank you.
Four guys, who think that Shaul should start by taking his jacket off? Raise your hand. Shaul?
I've been asked to undress on stage many times
you
before.
You have to follow the sentiment of the crowd.
But I want to say that I'm honored to receive fashion advice from Dr. Vardy here, who little known fact is that, well, two little known facts. One, that he was coronated as the worst male dresser in Israel by Israel's largest publication. So
that's true. 2010.
It was in 2010, but ever since then, they stopped that polling. So it's like, you know, he won it indefinitely, and there's no need to continue the quest. And the other thing is that one of the world's most acclaimed tech journalists, Kara Swisher, said that Yossi Vardy is a person that always looks like an untucked bed. So anyway.
My answer was, what is more inviting? You know, a very neat, cleaned, arranged bed or unmade bed. Everybody can choose his own thing. Adam, you put this, for those who don't know how you disturb the use of the internet, he is the guy who is putting these little icons at the, icons you call them?
Thumbnails.
Pictures at the end of every article of every magazine and try to tempt you to go to totally different areas from what you intended to see, right?
Yeah.
Did you mention how many times people are clicking on this per day?
Per day, almost 50 million times.
50 million times. So you are distracting. You know that nobody actually is interested, that you are manipulating them to do it.
No,
they want to read an article.
Finally, we're giving the world the mirror of what people really like. No, so actually.
No. That's very good. Tell us what really people like.
It depends when. So if you look
don't
at the top.
Don't avoid what people really like. You
horrible
know
things. Top 10 reasons for something, something.
Something, something like what?
What furniture you look like?
Pardon?
What furniture you look what like?
I never saw what furniture you look like. You are now what people are interested.
It's usually there is the entertainment stuff, anything from Kim Kardashian to whatever it is. You have evergreen things, which is how to cook and how to do different things that stays forever. One of the top pieces of content that I do remember was that got about 40 million Americans to read it was the top 10. Wealthiest women in the world. So people are very curious at listicles and things that are top.
So I go to read about the new world structure, you know, and the philosophy of the universe, and instead you are distracting me and you're coming with the top 10 richest women
first of all,
in the world.
Remember, it's personalized, so if you see it, it means you may like it.
Aha. Uh-huh.
What, you know, I see content about drones.
What?
Even about our moderator is doing a great job. Thank you, Yossi. I'll take over for a second.
Okay,
I want to ask
ahead,
you. So
ahead.
Beyond what's popular, we all know what are the more, you know, we all know that sports and entertainment are more popular than, you know, history and geography. But how big is the, you know, weight and consideration of the time of the day in which you read an article, the platform on which you
this
read
this is exactly the question which I wanted to ask.
So,
that's what I heard
you
as well.
Go ahead,
thanks, you gentlemen. So, no, it takes, we look at over 100 things from platform to time of day to how did you get to the page, from a search engine, from a social website, geography, which country. So, if I'm in New York, even if I'm the same person and I go to San Francisco, I'll see different things. Mm-hmm. So we have interaction with Twitter to see what's the popular thing socially where I'm at right now, so the Mexico in Cologne. So all these things are blended, and then we're trying to take a really good guess.
Who are the 10 richest women in the world?
I think Pepsi CEO is one of them.
Who?
I think Pepsi CEO is one of them.
Pepsi CEO.
But I can't remember the name.
She's a very capable lady.
She's okay.
Another personal question, if I may. Are you married?
I am. She hasn't kicked me out yet. I'm 1 year anniversary, just happened. And I'm very...
Did you select your wife from the top 10?
You know, I'm the only Israeli who left Israel to marry a Polish woman. And she speaks Polish natively, so I'm very proud of that. And I do believe... przecież tutaj teraz.
No. But if you married a Polish woman, we know you didn't marry a Polish woman, you married a Polish mother-in-law and you got the the wife as part of the deal, right?
From Jersey. Yeah, and I think the success to our marriage is actually the fact that I'm half the time traveling, so the other husband is doing an amazing job keeping her happy. I think that's the key to the success.
Yoav, are you using his technology in your business, or are your clients using his technology?
Yeah, I think everyone is using this kind of technology. What I hope that Kenshu is doing its share by lowering the barrier to entry when it comes to monetization. I think a lot of amazing businesses like Adam's is coming around, and you have this access to consumers here. How do you make money from it? And given the amazing work done by Facebook, Google, it's very hard for those amazing businesses to cross.
And how you add into equation? What is the added value of your platform?
So the hope is that if you have a truly independent framework, technology framework that is totally unbiased according to branding and marketing, but rather kind of rewards on the marginal contribution and return, that budgets will shift as according to where value resides. And if you're a marketeer trying to reach consumers, you might as well shift, you know, in the billions to companies like Taboola. And that's a technology play. That cannot be done by any other form. So if we do our job right, we tend to joke in Kenshu that this industry has become a black hole instead of being a sun. So it seems to be sucking everything in, and you know, not even light can exist. And we try to open it up and hopefully let other businesses grow and make money. So let's see, the journey is still ahead.
Adam, but last question and then I will go to Shaul. I understood from what you say that these thumbnails are personalized. You mean you serve them according to what you think about the user interest?
When people like you.
Yeah, so this is kind of what you understand from my subconscious that I'm interested in.
I think your subconscious specifically is not easy to read, but we do the best we can.
For me, I must tell you, can I say something? It may be a little bit offensive.
I have no emotions.
Yeah, you are able to take it?
Yeah.
To me, it looks like a conspiracy that you have with the governments of the world to lower the IQ of the voters in order to assure that these governments will be elected next. Is it true?
So we do have.
Come on, admit it, Adam. That's.
I mean, I spent 7 years in the Israeli army, and this is all actually an extension of my previous job. That's really what it is. It's an army project.
It's an army project. They will buy it, you know.
Who will buy it?
What have you done in the army?
I was an engineer.
And that's all he can say.
In a secret unit.
Okay. Now, your company was founded where?
In Tel Aviv.
Your company was founded where?
Likewise, Tel Aviv.
Your company was founded?
As well, Tel Aviv.
Yeah, so these are, I forgot to tell you, the panel is about three Israeli company, if you were not able to figure it so far.
As our accent strongly suggests, we do come from the Holy Land.
Yeah.
Good. Why? What now, Adam and Shaul and Yoav, tell me a little bit how you perceive the Israeli. Be careful because this lady is taking video of everything you are saying and it may be used against you.
Most likely.
You can continue to do it, it's okay. We are used to surveillance. You ever heard about 8200? Adam, tell me about the Israeli stuff compared to your other country stuff.
I mean, I think Israel is great. It's an amazing place to start a company. I don't think it's a big market, but it's a great place to start. You have access to unbelievable engineers and people that have really big dreams to do out of Israel. People don't know this, but Israel is really a country of foreigners. So everybody's, you know, if you're not a foreigner, you're a foreigner. And then everybody, there's a notion of there's nothing to lose. So people try things all the time. Sometimes it's a bit annoying.
Why we have the notion of nothing to lose?
I don't know, because it's like an Israeli thing. You feel like you wake up in the morning and people start new things all the time. And And I think it builds this culture of entrepreneurship. Sometimes it's a bit annoying, I was about to say, because Israelis also think they know everything. But if you take
what do you mean they think?
They know everything. No, that's what I meant. But outside of that, it's a really good place to incubate innovation, and then from there, go and try to conquer the world and bring technology to other places.
And the hummus is amazing.
The hummus is really good.
Look, we are a very global company. We have offices in the United States, in Europe, in Asia, in Latin America, and in Tel Aviv as well, our first office. And today, Playbus is kind of a melting pot of a lot of different cultures because we're also working with content partners and with consumers all over the world. I think that much like New York, which is where both Adam and I are based, Israel is also very cosmopolitan in the sense that it's a mixture of a lot of cultures together.
New York is a suburb of Tel Aviv, right?
In a way, yeah, a subsidiary of Tel Aviv, and you know, it's a great place to incubate ideas because of this sort of open mindset and exposure to different cultures. It's also very typical, you know, you have recently moved back to Israel, but all of us realize that in order to grow our businesses,
if there were Israelis in the audience, they would have applauded for.
But we all realize that at a certain point
that
Dr. Vardi, if I may, that
you
in
may,
order to grow our businesses, we have to go outside
age,
of Israel.
But he has chutzpah as if he's older than me. But go ahead. That's fine.
We have to go out of Israel in order to grow our businesses because, as Adam mentioned, Israel is not a standalone market on its own. You know, it's not a sustainable market. So a company that wants to grow and wants to reach scale has to go out of Israel, and then when you want to reach global markets, you have to be in those global markets, which is really counterintuitive because the internet is all about immediate access to everywhere. But at the end of the day, business is still done not only by machines talking to each other, but by human beings talking to each other, understanding each other, feeling each other, developing trust. And all of that needs to be done on a face-to-face basis. So
anybody who understands what he said, please raise your hand.
Yeah. And what about the jacket?
Not bad, not bad. Shaul, yeah. You are doing strides. Yoav, Israel.
Israel, how many of you have been to Israel?
Good question.
All right. So those that have
not
been,
please come.
No, let me
show you the wonders of mathematics. So about 30% have been. How many of you never been to Israel? Raise your hand. You see, another 30%. 40% don't have any idea what we are trying to do here.
So please come. I think Israel is you can't ignore it. When you come, you either love it or you say, I won't come back. Most people love it. From the people standpoint, what I can say, and I just said it the other day, between two points, never an Israeli person will walk the straight line.
Yeah.
If you give very strict kind of instructions and say you have to work to go on the straight line from A to B. No, I know a better way. Hey, do whatever you like. You assume, you know, reverse psychology. No, there will be its own way. So
Let me help you. The Israeli thinking is that a straight line between two points is the longest line you can pass between these two points.
Yeah. And if you can harness that, to Adam's point, you get wonderful things. And yeah, it might get frustrating every now and then, but that's the beauty of it. I also think that Israel in business, unlike the foreign affairs that we conduct, we actually do a very good job.
Did I hear some criticism about the...
All good.
Adam's friends from the government.
All good. Happy from the politics.
We are a small country surrounded by very big government.
Yeah. So I think we give a lot of respect to the market, and we invest a lot trying to understand what the market needs when it comes outside of Israel, and this is out of necessity, and I think that helps, you know, this match between creating solid innovative technologies
why this is for the three of you. Why we have such an intense industry in edtech?
As I said, I think for us, technology can solve almost any issue. So it starts with this idea, but then it's, but can I actually do something about it? Because it's very nice to have ideas and sell promises. Promise selling is the easiest in the world, but can you actually get it done all the way? And this is a lot of figuring out to do. You cannot hope to have a study and just, you know, do it from A to B and it's going to work. you're going to have a lot of figuring out to do, and every now and then go back and redo, etc. So I think that mentality definitely helped us figure out if there is a need, there is a solution, we just need to get there.
Shaul, why we are so...
The reason that we gravitate towards EdTech is for the same reason that people use to rob banks, because that's where the money is. So essentially, it's, you know, it's a very practical thing. If you want to do something that's going to make an impact, go to where the nerve center is.
Sigolda?
I think that actually it's where the, it's relatively easier to get to few millions of dollars in EdTech, 5 million, 7 million, 10 million. So I think it's not only, it's not necessarily where the money is, I think it's where the easier money is perceived to be. So you get a lot of people that try to get to that hanging fruit revenue, but it's much harder to, you know, to build a big software company or something that can stay here forever.
What is the future of the industry, according to your views?
I hope it's not Facebook. No, I'm joking. So I think that I do think that there's going to be a big transition to walled garden and platforms that will try to fight for consumers. I think we're entering an attention economy era. So the next 10 years will be fighting hard for people's attention. It used to be www, and I'm not sure what it's going to be the next 10 years. We hope that it's going to be personalized and relevant, not only on the web, but actually wherever you go, it's going to be relevant for me.
Shaul?
I think that the future, or you know, even the present, is that people no longer, people meaning advertisers, publishers, and consumers alike, no longer follow the herd. They're no longer willing to consume what people dictate for them that they should consume. They're no longer willing to pay in standard models. They're now really looking after engagement. Advertisers want to see actual engagement and not just pay blank for a wholesale inventory that has an 80% bounce rate or whatever. And publishers are beginning to understand that they cannot continue to create content the same way they did 100 years ago. So they are looking to new innovative formats of content creation. And in short, it's becoming an on-demand world in which only the
strongest and most interesting just try to disturb us. Go on, go on.
But see, you know, it would have been a bad sign if we started in a full hall and then nobody would stay by the time we finished. We had the opposite. At first, you know, there were more people on stage than
the
audience.
I am asking myself what's coming next. Why all of a sudden
people,
everybody...
The word about my jacket spread out and everybody got...
I think you're reading it incorrectly. People are tweeting and everybody's coming because, like, what is...
What is the next panel? Nobody knows. Okay, before we go, Shaul, what is the best... now we are going to do some shameless promotion. What is the best tech event in Israel?
Whichever tech event you're organizing.
What is the best tech event in Israel?
It's called DLD.
And it's coming when?
On September 25th.
Right, and anybody who wants to come, send me an email. And I will send you an invitation. My email is yossi@vardi.com. This was a cheap promotion, but why not take
it? Very effective.
You want to do any cheap promotion? Quickly. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, you were wonderful. I'm not sure you had any idea what we are talking about, but at least the four of us had a lot of fun because of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.